Take your seats. It is such an honor for me to do this too. How exciting I get to host this panel, the comeback panel. And the way we're going to format this is I'm going to let both of my lovely guests here tell you a little bit about their sickness stories, and then I'm going to let them tell you a little bit about their wellness stories, and then they are going to show you some stuff. All right. So first of all, I'd like to let Maddie give us some background. So Maddie Mae Rudd lives in Oakland with her significant other, Brendan, and she has a background in doing community website management and many other more techie types of things. Yes. Oh, can you hear this better now? There you go. Thank you. Alrighty, so as I said, Maddie Mae Rudd has a background in tech and website, and she currently has a website known as Ruud Awakenings, Maggie Mae Ruud. Pretty cool, huh? And she is going to share with us a little bit about her history, and you want to take five and give us some of your background.
Thanks, Afton. Can everyone hear me okay? Am I hitting this right? All right, I don't have a lot of experience with mics. My name is Maddie Ruud. And I live in Oakland with my partner, Brendan, and our adopted dog. I've been in pain for about 5.5 years now, which I know is small peanuts compared to many of you here today and listening at home. And what happened for me is that I just came down with the flu. I had a virus, and as you often get with a virus, a headache due to the swelling in my head. And I also got some weird kind of little spots on myself that looked kind of like chicken pox, but they weren't itchy. And I thought, this is kind of weird. I should go to the doctor. The doctor said, don't worry about it. You know, we'd have to do a whole bunch of testing to figure out what virus this is. It'll probably go away. Take lots of fluids, rest, and if these spots don't go away, come back in a few days. Well, the spots went away, but the headache did not. As I continued to be in pain, I started to think, well, this is something really wrong. And I went to the doctor. I had a CAT scan. They couldn't tell what was going on. I was referred to a neurologist. And at this point, I had been in pain, constant severe frontal pain, for several weeks. And this first neurologist was incredibly unhelpful. He did a few things which are really important to do, like putting me on an elimination diet to make sure that it wasn't allergies or something like that. But he also had some strange ideas, like that I was in terrible pain because I was sighing too much. I took too many deep breaths. And that was causing me, apparently, to be in terrible pain all the time. This doctor subsequently closed his practice and left me high and dry. But I wasn't too unhappy about that at this point. I saw a new neurologist. And got a referral to UCSF after an EEG, MRI, MRA, spinal tap, or lumbar puncture, as it's known, and on a medication carousel, jumping on and off, taking blood pressure medication. They had me on antidepressants for a while, migraine prophylactics, all kinds of stuff. And I was referred to this headache specialist at UCSF who said, oh, well, sometimes this happens, that somebody gets a headache with a virus and it continues, it persists for a few months, but it never lasts more than 3 months. And at this point, I had been in pain for 2 years. He told me, you know, just continue on. It'll get better. I've never seen this last more than 5 years. Or at 5.5. And so I had to come through the grieving process and figure out how to try to restore as much joy and meaning and functionality to my life as I could while I was in the midst of losing a lot of things. Losing relationships, friends who just don't understand or can't put the required energy into seeing you. Losing my job. I had to leave my job, which I really loved. And feeling that career slipping away from me. Losing a lot of physical function. Right now, I leave my home one or two times a week. Literally. That's how much I leave my house. And I continue to try to push those boundaries and cultivate resilience, which is our theme today. And we'll talk more about that a little later.
Perfect. Okay, so yeah, I didn't want you to get into the good stuff yet. And so our other panelist today is Christina Kish, and she also has a fascinating background also in technology. She was one of the founding members of Netflix back in the day, and her body, though, had other plans for her. Now, though, part of her comeback is starting Potential, and you'll hear a lot about her Potential.
Thank you. So my friends call me CK, so we're all friends now, right? So you guys can call me CK. I'm a California girl, and I was born here, raised here, educated here. I have a BS from Cal Poly San Luis Obispo, and I have an MBA from Golden Gate, San Francisco. I spent a huge amount of my career in software companies doing e-commerce, and then before that, consumer software. Yes, back when we still bought software off of shelves. Some of you may remember that. I have two amazing little cats. Their birthday is today. They're 9/11 babies. They're named Phoenix and Faith, and they're 14 today, and they're named appropriately. I have a husband that we've been together for 30 years, and he's been my support system and my caregiver many of the times. We're spending this week doing that new trend called conscious uncoupling. He will still remain my family and my support system, but I'm working on my next comeback. So I'm hoping next year Cynthia invites me back. Maybe I can talk about coming back, chronic pain and dating. So I'm working on that story as next, yeah. So I did start Netflix, as Afton mentioned. That was my last hurrah before going ahead and letting the pain take a little bit more control of what I do during the week, which is pain management. And all of you, I'm sure, are familiar with that. The fun in that is that you get to go and get a life, as I often talk about. When I left my job, I went to go get a life. And I'll talk today about some of the things I found along the way and going out and getting that life. My pain, I'm a 20-year chronic pain survivor. It started one morning, I woke up and I thought I had a sinus headache, and it just never went away. And the way I describe the pain, it's behind both eyes, and it's a squeezing pain. And the way I like to describe it to people is if you went shopping, which is always fun, and you put those bags on your arms, and you walk around the mall for a couple hours, and you keep adding a few more bags to your arm as you're going out to the car and you're carrying your great purchases out to the car. You go to put the bags into the trunk of the car. And when you take those bags off, you know that feeling that your arm is just kind of tired and achy? That's the feeling behind both eyes 24/7. It has not been diagnosed. The brilliant minds at Stanford, come on, that has to get a laugh, you guys. The brilliant minds at Stanford, after ink blot tests, after putting cocaine plaquettes up the nasal passages, after lots of drug trials, after lots of wonderful things, have deemed me complicated. I kind of like that diagnosis. I'm going with it. I'm going with complicated. And a nerve's gone haywire somewhere. We don't know which nerve or how to treat it. And so the rest of my story we'll talk about on how I've decided to treat it.
Excellent. And now the comeback.
So one of the things that we're specifically talking about today is dance. Christina and I have this in common. And burlesque is something that has changed my life completely. Surprise, surprise. But I never thought I would do something like burlesque. Taking my clothes off in public did not really appeal to me. But I happened to be at a bachelorette party for one of my very dear friends who was getting married. And as part of the bachelorette activities, we had this sort of burlesque class with a woman who became my very dear friend. Her name is Kalita. I just, for whatever reason, decided to let it go, let it all hang out. And I was just having a great time, prancing around, making campy faces. And Kalita came up to me afterwards and said, you have an inner showgirl, and she really needs to get out. So come dance with me. And I thought about this for a while. I didn't say yes right away. I thought, oh, well, that's very flattering and that's sweet, but I don't really know this woman, and the thing that draws me to her is her energy, her positive energy. But I decided to try it out. And so that year, I danced with a troupe called the Hot Pink Feathers in the San Francisco Carnival Parade, which is a huge deal in San Francisco, really fun, lots of costumes, sparkle, feathers everywhere, and also lots of skin. And I had this sort of moment on the parade day when we were getting ready, and I'd been really anxious about it and self-conscious about my body and unsure if I could really go through with it. But amongst all these women of very different shapes and sizes, very different levels of dance background and experience and gracefulness, I will tell you, I am super clumsy. And I looked around at all these women and felt this wonderful energy, and I just felt like everyone was so beautiful. Not because of the makeup and the hair, but because here we were bringing our authentic selves and celebrating our bodies, celebrating each other's bodies, things that we can do that feel good to us. And so that was really the call to burlesque for me, was this idea of being in pain especially. We tend to look at our bodies as something that we need to fight or control. Sometimes it feels like the enemy. And so to have this positive experience of body, just going for it and having fun and celebrating and not caring what other people think about it, became very empowering for me. I did discover through this process that my pain was not going to allow me to continue to dance at that level. I cannot commit to a weekly rehearsal. There's just no way for me to do that. If I did go to that weekly rehearsal, then I'm wiped out for several days afterwards and can't do anything except lie on the couch. But what happened for me is that instead of focusing on the grief that I was feeling in not being able to do what I wanted to do as fully as I wanted to do it, I started to look for ways to be involved that that I could do, that were within reach. And some of those ways involve maybe pushing the cart with the water in it during the parade instead of dancing, or being backstage and stage managing, production managing for solo showcases and floor shows. And through these activities, I still get to be part of the community, which anchors me and helps me feel rewarded and alive and active. I still get to bask in the energy of these women who are going for it and who are being themselves and who are not ashamed of whatever it is that they're bringing to the table, because we all have something really fun and amazing to bring to the table.
Wonderful, thank you. And that's your story of resilience. It's so empowering. So many people with chronic pain feel like their body has betrayed them. Body image is such a big problem. And it's more than just, am I thin enough or fit enough? It's like, do I connect with, even understand my body? And this seems like such an empowering part of your story. Thank you. And now your story.
So as I mentioned, and Afton was so nice to credit me with the founding of Netflix, I did that while in pain. And every day I had to make that decision on whether or not I was going to be able to get up and start that company. And unfortunately, one day when I tried to get up to go and after it had launched, so it had launched, I did that part, I realized that this was not going to be something I could see out for a long time in coming. It was going to be something that I needed to let go of and give it to others who have done a phenomenal job with it. In doing that, I decided I was going to go find, get a life then, right? And wasn't quite sure what that meant, because your identity gets wrapped up in a job, especially when you're starting something as big as what I had done. And so getting a life to me meant I had to go find things of quality. And I tried a lot of different things. And a big part of that is when you're working Silicon Valley and starting a company, you don't exercise, you don't eat well. You are all about starting that company. And so that's kind of where I started, was trying to eat well and exercise. And I get bored easily as far as exercise goes. And so I tried a lot of different things. And I started with Pilates, which I loved. And unfortunately, again, I kind of take things to the next level. So I had to become a Pilates instructor, of course, because I had to pay for my habit of actually taking Pilates, right? And one day I ran into some friends who had gone up to a pole dancing studio and did a class for someone's birthday. And I'd been doing Pilates for a couple months, and I thought, I'm getting strong. I want to go try this. And it was the best hour and a half of my life. And it definitely changed my outlook on a lot of things. So I have a question for all of you. You just heard me say pole dancing. So what words and images came into your mind? I can guess. I can definitely guess what they are. Let me tell you what words come to my mind. The words that come to my mind when I hear pole dance is empowerment, strength, joy, satisfaction, love, family, goals. The images that come to my mind are probably different than the ones that came to your mind as well. I see a young 30-something single mom who just beat breast cancer, who wants to be back on the pole as soon as possible, because that's where she feels strong and having control of her body instead of her body having control of her. I see the kindergartner teacher who took forever to get diagnosed with Lyme disease and is fatigued most of the time, who just wants to get into the studio and hear the music and be with her dance partner, which in our case is a pole. I see the young kid of Chinese descent whose parents don't really understand him or his love for Brazilian dance, and I know that's kind of a strange thing, but when he found pole, he also found his body and was able to go and make decisions for himself and not just what his family wanted him to do. I see the RSD survivor who truly believed her body had given up on her and didn't want to have anything to do with it, really, who can't wait to get to the studio every week because it's one place where her body doesn't betray her. I see the man who is going through transgender surgeries, who comes into the studio to learn a different kind of movement. Pole dancing, we've tried all kinds of names for it. We call it pole fitness, we call it aerial arts. We try to use different words so that people don't automatically think strip club. It's a community that has built itself over the last 10 or 15 years to look towards people who want something off the beaten track. They are going to show up, and they don't really care if their friends do. So many of you in this room were coming today, whether your friends were going to get in the car with you or not. I really feel that chronic pain survivors are unique individuals. We have to be. we look at our uniqueness every time we go into the doctor's office, and they look at us like we have three heads, right? And that's our uniqueness. So I really think that when we go and find things to add to our life, and like when we look at the post-it notes up there, we probably found some things that are unique because we are unique. So when I try to justify why I love pole dance, I actually don't try to justify it. I just say that it's as unique as I am. Me being me, instead of just going and taking classes, I had to open a studio. So my entrepreneurial spirit won out 9 years ago, and this is our birthday this month, 9 years. I opened Potential. The name is very much on purpose because when I started, it really was, well, what does this have the potential to be for me and for others? And I've spent 9 years now getting to know what that answer is. This weekend is one of our community's big expos in Las Vegas. And so I'm looking through Facebook of all the posts of all my extended family there in Las Vegas celebrating the uniqueness of the workout, the dance, the athleticism, the fitness, the what we call the pole community. I can go anywhere in this world and there will be someone from pole that will pick me up at the airport and let me sleep on their couch. That's what kind of community I was able to find. And I would not have found that community, and I would not have had the business that I have if I hadn't had left the normal working world and gone to find a life. When Afton asked us to put something in the piggy bank, what I put was when I woke up this morning, as what happens very frequently, I wake up in the morning and I see pictures that were taken at my studio from the night before when I wasn't there. So I get to see what's called shenanigans, a lot of shenanigans, of a lot of fun that's being had when I'm not there. There's a lot of fun when I'm there too. But the post today really kind of touched my heart because it was a trick that a woman finally was able to achieve. And she posted a picture of it. This woman was diagnosed with Graves' disease. She was on tons of medication. She bruises very easily. She walks out of the studio smiling, and look at my bruises, because it's someplace where she can feel, and it's someplace where she can meet goals that are not out in her work world or her world in going what I call doctor hopping. In the post, it thanked a bunch of people that we see every day, but we thank them anyways. And I was thanked. And I get a post like that almost every day where someone's come into my studio and they thank me for creating the space that I've given to them. And what they don't know is that the biggest thanks is me thanking them. Because what they're able to give me is that break. I get that break from not looking just at my treatment plan or how I'm going to get through this week. I get to go in there. And when I'm in that studio, nothing else exists. I have a great dance partner. It's a pole. My studio has 20-foot ceilings, so I have 20 feet of pole. And it's the best partner because it doesn't talk back. It follows well. It sometimes leads, but it follows well. I gain muscle strength, I gain movement, I get to put the music on as loud as I want, and I get to dance. I don't dance well, I don't have a background in dance, but boy, is it fun. So I'm gonna get a chance to share a little bit more about that with you, and I'm gonna get a chance to give you a couple ideas and maybe you might wanna try it.
Great, thank you. And I didn't want to cut you short, but I sadly have a plane to catch that's not going to wait for me. So I'm going to turn over the emceeing duties to very capable and beautiful hands. And what is going to occur next, actually, if you two can talk a little bit about your resilience, the things, the messages that you wanted to leave with them, and each spend a couple minutes just talking about it, because you told me some critical messages, and I think they're so lovely, of how you've achieved resilience. And then they're going to show you some things that I'm so sad I'll miss.
Thanks, Afton. Thank you, Afton.
I'm so amazed by you two role models. I'm so inspired. And as a ballerina, you know how to dance, darling. And I just want to hear more. I'm so intrigued by the communities that you've both found. And is there another community that you're interested in, Maddie?
Okay.
I think touching on this and touching on what Afton left us with as far as what messages we want to leave from our stories. Another example of how I have invested in a community, even though I cannot do as much as I would like, is actually roller derby. Women's flat track roller derby. If you haven't been, you need to go. It is so fantastic. It is not like what you remember from the 80s with staged fights and you know who's going to win and good guys and bad guys. It is a real sport with incredible, incredible athleticism. It's something that I really enjoy being around and being a part of. But skating makes me vomit. So I can't really do that very often. I get on my skates maybe 10 minutes every 6 months. But I was unable to skate with the league in the way that I wanted to. And I found instead that I could take tickets at the door at roller derby bouts and greet people and get them excited as I am about it. And I tell this story because it teaches a similar lesson for me, which is that you need to choose every day as a practice. There is no moment of, I mean, there are moments where you get insight and there are moments where you get clarity. There are moments where you feel, oh my gosh, this is calling to me, I need to follow this. But there's no magical enlightenment after which life is so much easier with pain. Resilience is something that you have to practice every day. And sometimes I'm better at it than others. But I try to continue to give myself the messages over and over again. Okay, so given that those options are not on the table for me, given that I can't roller skate, given that I can't do this burlesque showcase, what is it that I can do? Instead of focusing on what I've lost as much as I can, I try to look forward and I try to say, okay, so this day really went badly. Everything that I planned went wrong and I didn't achieve anything I wanted to achieve today. Okay, given that, rather than spend my energy on beating myself up about that or being frustrated or angry about the pain, given that things went wrong, what is my next available best choice? What can I do right now that would feel good to me, that would improve my mood, whether it's going out for a walk and being in nature, which releases a huge amount of pain-killing opioids in your brain, those endogenous opioids that Dr. Hassett was talking about earlier. Just being in nature, looking at a beautiful view, decreases your pain. There have been studies that show that people in hospital beds that have windows overlooking nature instead of facing a brick wall, they actually are released from the hospital much quicker, and they require less pain medication while they're in the hospital. Making these small choices. I'm going to do a dance for you in a moment. My costume, my choreography, not the most professional. I'm not a seamstress. I'm not a makeup artist. I'm certainly not a graceful person. But I can put this together in my living room. I did put this together in my living room in its entirety. And maybe burlesque doesn't call to you. Maybe pole doesn't call to you. But there is something out there for you that will call to you. Some way of being in your body or being in community, being in relationship with others that will call to you, that will feel good. And the way to find that is just to try a lot of new things, which also actually is a resilience building tool, it turns out. Perfect. Couples who try new things together have longer relationships. So there we go. That was my little lessons, little takeaways.
And I'm curious, Christina, do you have to be an awesome athlete to go to your studio?
So what I love about pole dance aerial arts is that I have all shapes, all sizes, all age groups. I have people who have not ever worked out. I have people who are ex-somethings, ex-ballet dancers, ex-gymnasts. I have people who can't lift their body weight, but they can dance. We do train for competition. We do train for performance. And we do just go in there and work out, too. One of the things that Cynthia and I talked about in the last couple weeks was that we're not touching really on the acceptance part today. We're talking about what happens after acceptance. And in a way, for me, it's a little bit about the same thing. Is when I was working Silicon Valley, I always gave myself the option to quit a job I didn't like. So my pain acceptance story is I was doctor hopping and looking for an answer, and I realized it became a full-time job. And just like in the past, when I wanted to quit a job, I quit it. So I decided to quit that. That's my acceptance story. The same is true for when I went to go find a life. I'd try something. If I didn't like it, I didn't have to stay with it until I just said yes to that next thing. So just keep saying yes.
Do you want to dance?
Yeah. Can I just say one thing?
If you've never been to burlesque before, don't worry. I am fully covered. I'm not going to be flashing anyone today. It's pretty tame. But if you've never been to burlesque before, audience participation, highly encouraged. Hooting, hollering, whistling, laughing.
Do you take tips?
No tips. It's all for the love of you guys today.
Yeah, I wanted to bring a pole in. I really wanted to bring a pole in. But Christina, you have a better idea. So because you don't have to be an awesome dancer in your studio to pole, and we want to teach people that, you know, everybody, every woman in pain can do this. I mean, it sounds crazy, but it's true. And when are you going to teach me how to pole?
I'm ready.
Okay, we're going to teach about that. Okay. Okay.
Okay. So I decided to not bring you pictures of my studio or us in competition or anything that we do in the outside world or at the studio. I decided instead to show you polling at home. A photographer named Thomas Sanders and I have been working on this project where he's been going into the homes of many of my students. We all have poles in our houses too. Even though we go to the studio, we have them up in our houses as well. And so I decided to share with you some of these polling from home photography that he's worked on. Everyone that you see in these pictures has regular jobs. They're teachers, they're marketing execs. There's an actress, this is a librarian that you see right now. As you see that in their homes, it's like you might have a treadmill in your home. We have a pole. You'll see that their families are encouraging. That's me in my kitchen right there. You'll see families. You'll see dogs and cats and children and parents in these photos. You'll see our poles in our kitchens, garages, bedrooms, dens, pole rooms. You'll see that we're all shapes, all sizes, all different fitness levels. You'll see smiles. When Tom went to do these pictures, he asked a couple things of us. One is he said, don't wear black. And so you're going to see color in these photographs. He wanted us to be a part of our environment, and black would have just not shown really us on the pole. It wouldn't have stood out. He also asked for us to not have the perfect pose or show you our absolute most favorite perfect move. So some of our toes aren't pointed. some of our legs aren't straight. But this is us in our environment, and I can guarantee you that every session that you're seeing here, there was joy, there was release. Many of the people that you see in the pictures have maybe visited a studio, but a lot of them may have learned what they're learning at home. There are several online communities that offer video tutorials. There are forums that you can get some instruction just from your home, and you don't need to leave and make that trek out to a studio. The pole community is an incredibly supportive community, and if you do wander into studio, you will be welcomed. Again, no matter shape, size. We do have men and women, and as I said before, all ages, all athleticism levels, shapes and sizes. And as you can see, the animals love us. There's nothing better than a pole as a scratching post or a cat to rub up against. When you do go online, just look up pole fitness or pole dancing, and you're going to see a lot of amazing things that are available. Here, and if you're here locally in Los Angeles, there's many, many studios, and they would all be very happy to have you there. And if you don't want to leave your home, there are polls available for you. And lots of, like I said, online tutorials and whatnot. Tom and I have been working on this project, Polling at Home, and he's had several installations at museums. He's been featured in Russian Esquire, as well as a lot of other online publications. We're hoping that we can take this series to another level. So just like I'm sharing this with you today, something you might not have ever seen, we're hoping to share this in larger ways as well. And I think we're almost to the end of this. And once Maddie gives us her performance, I think we'll open it up to a few minutes for questions as well.
It's so fascinating to me, Christina and Maddie, that you both found burlesque and pole after you had pain. So we can all, you're teaching us that we can all think outside the box and find something wonderful and fabulous to do that most women who don't have pain would never do.
When I show you this picture, I do have to say something that pole does hurt. And we wear few clothing because skin is what sticks us to the pole. And I was kind of trying to cover up my legs, so I'm always being bruised. But as chronic pain survivors, you'll kind of understand the hurt so good concept of having that kind of pain versus the pain you're dealing with on a daily basis is sometimes very welcome. And so that's kind of the masochistic side of pole dance, is that those of us who do suffer chronic pain just get to have a new pain, that, and it's kind of fun, and you get to go into all these great poses, and you get to dance. And so if anybody, if you've learned something here today, right? We don't take our clothes off because we want to. It is for a purpose. It's to stick to the pole.
And the wall. Oh, there it is.
Wow.
Misdiagnosis. There it is. There it is. A wardrobe malfunction. You know, what would be a live performance without a wardrobe malfunction? You're gorgeous. Absolutely amazing.
Are we coming back up for Q&A?
Oh, yeah. Back up a little bit more for Q&A. Please, Christina and Maddie, please come on up. Any questions? Any questions from the audience about this amazing work or what impetus behind it? Yes. Yes.
I have a question about the fullness.
So, are there
any studios or any opportunities like with
panics
involved? I mean, you know, but seriously, is there something where you don't have to have that kind of upper body strength?
Yeah, absolutely. So, I'll answer that a couple different ways. My studio is, I'm in Redwood City, California, which is halfway between San Francisco and San Jose. I actually have two back-to-back studios. I have the pole studio and I have my aerial art studio, which does have aerial hammock, aerial silk, aerial lyra. Definitely look for an aerial hammock class. Here in the area, there's a studio called Urban Fitness, and they do some aerial hammock work. The great thing about aerial hammock is that it will take your weight without you having to lift into your weight. It's very freeing because you're up in the air and you're able to kind of move in that hammock, and it's a great way. The other thing about pole dance is you can do a lot without ever having to lift your body weight as well. And a fun way to start pole dance is get a group of you and go have a party and try it out. I'll warn you, it's addicting.
One would imagine. One would imagine. Any other questions? Yes?
I just want to add, there was just a soap opera just finished about a girl who used to do pole dancing and people who used to scream in her answer, and she had a job as a nanny in a very conservative household, and the guy was a widow with a kiss and falls in love with the nanny. So it was a big message for pole dancing and understanding the dynamics of just that. I might add that.
Thank you.
Right. Thank you.
Let's just say, like, for example, fibromyalgia, when you think exercise or the knee, you know, that, you know, like, oh, I'm not being as good. But how do you find that the more you move or you get in there, that your nerve pain or the muscle spasm limits itself, or you just work through it, or how does that work for each dance skill?
That's a great question. And for me, exercise does cause me additional pain, for sure. And that was one of the reasons why I couldn't commit to, you know, a weekly dance class or something like that. For me, the joy and fun that I find provide enough pain relief and distraction in those moments. I think that choosing the pacing is really important. I didn't just get up and, you know, dance for 5 minutes. You have to do things by degrees. Usually a good rule is to start with what you can do comfortably and then try to add 10%, whatever that is, 10% more time or increase your intensity. That's harder to, you know, measure, but to increase your resilience and your endurance, and it does get easier, maybe a full-length class is not going to work. Maybe 5 minutes here and there with some videos in your own home. You know, I never rehearsed this dance for more than 10 minutes at a time, and that probably showed. But you know, when you're doing it for fun, that's not what matters to you. If you're doing it for pain relief and for life satisfaction, then how it looks, how it comes out, if your sash is backwards or you trip on the carpet, You know? Was that the most important thing? No, I just feel like we had a really good time. And wasn't that, like, so worth it, even if I tripped and fell on my face, right?
Yeah, as we all in this room know, fatigue and exercise don't go together. But we need to exercise to beat the fatigue. And so that's why it's finding something that you love is really important. The other thing is, if you're going to do it from home, great, and pace yourself. If you're going to go into a studio, tell the instructor. But you tell them in a way like, I'm going to try everything you asked me to do, but I'm going to pace myself. Just tell the instructor.
Thank you, ladies. Thank you. That was just absolutely tremendous. Christina, Kish, and Maddie, Ruud.